Over the years, clients have come to my practice stating things like, I have no interest in things anymore, or I'm not feeling very well, I'm just down, and I can't seem to get motivated. Does any of this sound familiar to you? If so, you may be experiencing depression. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Mala. I'm the founder of Positive Health Solutions, where we offer you positive solutions for your physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual health. I specialize in psychotherapy, neurotherapy, and medical yoga. So welcome to my video series entitled Healing Journey, where I'll be focusing on the intersection of neuroscience, psychology, yoga, and mindfulness for impacting on healing and stress, anxiety, depression, general health, and spiritual issues, and many other similar topics. The techniques and concepts that I'm going to share with you are powerful and healing, and research has found them to be effective for influencing the healing of our nervous system, our emotions, and our mind. These techniques and concepts have the potential to make a difference in your health and happiness. If you're new here, please make sure you hit the subscribe button. It's free, and you'll get notified of additional healing videos. So let's get started. So what is depression? Depression is basically a constant feeling of sadness, loss of interest, things that stop you from doing your normal activities with your normal energy levels. Now, surprisingly, depression can also manifest as irritability, anger, and hostility. So symptoms can range from relatively minor to moderate to even more severe levels. The thing about depression is that as you experience low energy and sadness and lack of motivation, sometimes people will start to isolate themselves. And unfortunately, this makes depression worse. And isolation can intensify your symptoms. In order to deal with the sadness, many times people will start to self-medicate with food or alcohol or drugs in order to take the edge off or to shift how they're feeling. Self-medicating, unfortunately, in the long run, doesn't help, and it actually exacerbates the symptoms of depression. There are many types of depression that have multiple origins. So some examples are situational depression, and these are situational events that happen in your life, such as getting a divorce or getting fired from a job. There's also postpartum depression or seasonal affective depression or bipolar issues, and so on. But the bottom line is, sometimes depression is due to an imbalance in brain chemistry and genetic influence. And as I said, sometimes it is situational and due to some kind of loss or grieving, and sometimes it's related to environmental issues and our health status related to inflammation. So these origins, they can vary from one person to another. Depression can sometimes be complicated and complex, and in other situations, it can be rather straightforward. So I always recommend that if you do have moderate to severe levels of depression, that you make sure you check in with your doctor and get specific advice and guidelines for what to do. So in this video, I'm going to share with you some thoughts and ideas that I think will be helpful in moving your system from inactivity and lethargy and the dorsal vagal complex to a more alert and activation of energy through the ventral vagal and neural platform. And in doing so, we're going to be impacting on stress hormones of inactivation and moving things to more uplifting hormones such as dopamine, oxytocin, and serotonin. It's going to make a big difference. So whether it's working with your thoughts, your emotions, or your nervous system and the neural platforms, all the techniques should slowly start to make a difference in how you feel. The more you commit to your healing, the more effective the techniques will become over time. So let's just start with language and thought categories. So it's been said by many philosophers and wisdom people over the centuries that as you think, so shall you become. When we're in a depressed episode, our thoughts are usually negative, and we're in a very self-absorbed mindset. So the first thing we want to start with is the idea that just because you think a thought, it doesn't mean that thought is true or real. So it'll be helpful for you to work and attempt to have some objectivity related to your thinking patterns and how you're languaging things. Notice that there may be thoughts going through your mind that are exaggerated or not true, such as no one likes me, or everyone is against me, or I don't have any friends and no one cares about me. It's highly unlikely that any of these thoughts are true across the board. So it's going to be very helpful to put things in perspective and to identify only that which is 100% true and not an exaggeration. I have a friend that sometimes gets into globalizing things and exaggerating. So when she feels hurt or disappointed, she'll start to say things like, "All my children are ungrateful," when in fact it was only one of her children. Or when someone says something hurtful to her, she'll make statements such as, "No one likes me." So we have to be really careful about globalizing statements, which are really not accurate regarding your situation and the situation you're in. When we speak in those kind of absolute terms, our system literally absorbs them as if they're true. And then we start to believe those patterns and those thoughts. The thing is that our brain doesn't know the difference between reality and fantasy, and we're going to have the same neurobiological response to thought patterns. So when these thought patterns get absorbed into our system, our nervous system follows that line of thinking and then has the corresponding response. We then move into activation of stress hormones because our system believes that that thought is really true and real. So it's really important to start to change our thinking and put things more into perspective. And what's interesting is that research has found that the prevalence of absolutist words such as everyone, always, or no one is approximately 50% higher when someone is experiencing anxiety or depression. So as I mentioned, it is very important to begin the gentle process of changing our words and how we frame things. Another thing to consider about depression is that sometimes depression manifests as a result of repressed anger. When someone is unable to be assertive or set boundaries or establish that they have rights, there can be a backlash of resentment and anger that happens inside of ourselves. And when we're unable to express our anger or dissatisfaction with somebody, and when we repress those feelings, that energy turns into depression. So it's important to examine and ask yourself, am I angry or upset about something or towards somebody that is not resolved or complete? Because that certainly can contribute to feelings of depression. So when we think about the word expression, it is the opposite of depression. So D is down and X is up. So in overcoming depression, we want to activate the system. We want movement. So starting with health behaviors, yoga postures, and breathing practices, these types of things are important steps in overcoming depression. Research out of the University of Wisconsin in Madison has shown that chronic depression decreases our ability to regulate emotions and also reduces the size of our hippocampus, which is part of our memory bank in the brain. Chronic depression also increases the size of our amygdala, which is the threat center in the brain. The amygdala's job is to become vigilant in terms of assessing our threat, any kind of threat in our environment. We don't want to unnecessarily be assessing threat in our environment when there isn't any there. We also want to decrease what are called glucocorticoids in the system. And these are some of the stress hormones in the body that get activated around depression and also stress. And one last point before I take you through some specific techniques for impacting on depression, I'm going to share with you what is called GABA. It's gamma aminobutyric acid, and it's a neurotransmitter in the body that's responsible for calming the brain down. Without the effect of GABA, nerve cells fire too often and too easily. Low GABA levels are associated with depression, anxiety, PTSD, panic attacks, and epilepsy. So the antidepressant medications, the SSRIs, work actually by increasing our GABA levels. And what's interesting is that research has found that pranayama, the breathing practices, asana, meditation, all have the potential to increase GABA levels in the brain. And multiple studies have also shown that yoga practices compared with antidepressants work as well or better in increasing GABA levels in the brain. I think it's important that if you're struggling with depression, to really know and understand that the yoga practices, mindfulness, and meditation, it can be so helpful in increasing GABA levels in the brain. So let me take you through a technique that can assist in activating positive hormones in our system, okay? So lacing the hands, bring them behind the head, and gently turn the head to the right, and just wait there until you yawn, sigh, or take a deep breath. And then gently, let's turn to the left. Gentle pressure against the hands. And then just wait there until you yawn, sigh, or take a deep breath. Okay, and coming back to center point. Now you should have done one of those three things while you were pressing a little bit. And if you didn't, don't worry about it. But if you did, what happened is that we're activating the vagus nerve. And when we activate the vagus nerve, our system just goes into this relaxation response. And we're activating positive, calming, and happy hormones. And the brain is getting signaled to be more uplifted. So it's important to understand that our emotions affect the physical wiring of our brain. So we want to do what we can to lay down new neural pathways in the brain that are more in line with the ventral striatum, which is part of the reward circuitry in the brain. So the techniques that I'm going to show you contribute to that process happening. So here are some specific ideas and behaviors that can help impact on your depression levels. First, you want to set the tone for yourself every morning when you wake up. So as soon as you come into consciousness, I want you to think of the acronym KISS, K-I-S-S. KISS stands for kindness, inspiration, strengthen, and spiritualize. What we want to do is we want to decide what we're going to do today to be kind to ourselves, to inspire ourselves, to strengthen ourselves, and to somehow spiritualize our lives. So you make that decision before you even get out of bed. Inspire yourself in those moments when you're coming into consciousness. And don't let your mind travel down those other paths where you're thinking depressive thoughts. Also, it'll be very helpful to get up and let the sunlight be on your face and in your eyes. This helps to increase your serotonin levels. The next thing you want to do when you wake up is move around, jump around, or walk fast around the house or around the block, which helps to also increase serotonin levels. When you're in the shower, each time you step into the shower, have this formula. Be aware, notice, and feel. Feel the amazing sounds and the sensation of water on your body. Be in the present moment and just enjoy. So be aware, notice, and feel. Now, after showering, what's helpful to activate the vagus nerve is to take the towel or your hands and just rub in front and behind the ears. And then massage the neck and the throat area a little bit. This helps to activate uplifting and positive hormones in the system. When eating and drinking, be aware of the taste of the food or drink, the chewing, and the swallowing. Just slow things down a little bit so you're more in the present moment, and you'll be so much happier setting the tone of your day in this way. Okay, now I would like to give you some specific techniques that have found to be very helpful for reducing depression levels. So first, if you have any medical or health concerns, please do check with your doctor before doing any of these breathing practices. And we want to sit for 10 to 12 minutes or even more each day and do the following breathing practices with your eyes open. You can stare at a pleasant picture or some calming or inspiring colors. So the practice I'm going to share with you today is from the yoga practices, and it's called Kapalabhati. It's a forceful exhalation and a relaxed inhalation. So when we're practicing this, we want to make sure that it's a snapping motion inward, and we're pulling the diaphragm in and up a little bit. When we do this, it releases dopamine in the brain. And this breathing practice activates the system in a really powerful way and positive way. Do this practice 3 to 5 times with 15 repetitions each time, relaxing in between. And stop, of course, if there's any discomfort, and then relax and let the breath calm down. Now I'll lead you through the practice. So, number one, sitting in a chair or on the floor, you always want to start first the posture. So you slightly lift the rib cage and open up the stomach and the diaphragm area. So the diaphragm is a dome-shaped muscle right below the ribs. When you inhale, it goes down. And when you exhale, it goes up. With depressive symptoms, it's best to leave the eyes open and just softly stare at something. So you might notice the effects of a peaceful feeling coming over you when we do this, and that's what we want. So here we go. Staring at something soft. Lift the ribs. It's kind of like a choo-choo train. So we're exhaling. Soft inhalation. And then relax, take a breath, let the system settle. Okay, so go ahead and do this on your own now for 2 more rotations of 15 exhalations and having a little pause between. Okay, and gently coming back, and just take a moment and feel the effects of the Kapalabhati breath technique on your brain, on your hormones that just got released, and also on the body. If you don't feel anything, don't worry. It might take a little time to just get into the rhythm of doing this type of breathing practice. Okay, next, we're going to do what is called the double breath. Research has found that in doing the double breath, it opens up the alveoli in the lungs in a deeper way, allowing for a much better exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. As well, when we do diaphragmatic breathing, we allow the diaphragm when we exhale to go in and up. It slightly signals the brain to release a little burst of dopamine. And again, dopamine is that hormone that helps us to feel happier. The double breath is done by taking a deep breath, inhaling through the nose about 50% of the way. And then we kick into a deeper gear and we continue to breathe in with a deeper and fuller breath into the second part of the inhalation. So it looks like this. Good. So when we take in that double breath, inhale 50%, fuller 50% all the way, again, we get a slight dose of dopamine. So we're inhaling through the nose and then a tiny pause and we're exhaling through the mouth, nice and soft. So go ahead and practice this now, maybe about 5 times or so, and just be aware and just notice the positive calming effect on the mind and the nervous system. So don't worry if you don't feel anything right away. The more you practice this, the more powerful these practices take effect on the body. So here are your takeaway points for today. Each day, have small goals and behaviors to assist in changing your brain chemistry and your neural pathways. So practice that KISS concept: kindness, inspiration, strengthen, and spiritualize. And I really recommend that you put yourself, just think about putting yourself in the driver's seat and start to take charge of your neurobiology and your neural platforms. You're going to be so surprised at the impact of these techniques on your system. And then second, do the breathing practices every day, 1 to 3 times each day for about 10 to 12 minutes or longer if you want to. And again, you'll be so surprised at the amazing impact that these techniques have on our neural platforms and the upliftment of our moods and on our neurochemistry. So until next time, I'm Dr. Mala. Please take good care and namaste.